So tonight is mainly your night to ask questions. We'll have, I think, during the weekend, we'll have other opportunities to for us to ask questions. So I don't know what Dave and I have been traveling. We've just come. Dave is going to tell you.
So, some of you haven't ever met us yet. Me, Letitia and I were okay, so we have been followers of Swami Kriyananda-ji and disciples of Paramahansa Yogananda-ji, our guru, since Jyotish 1967, for me 1969, and we helped with others create the Ananda Cooperative Village in California. And then Swami asked us to help start many different centers around the world, in Italy, and helping care build masters work in India. So we've had a lot of opportunity to share the teachings with people all over the world. It's been a very great blessing to do this. And about 6 months before Swami left the body in 2013, he asked Jyotish and me if we would spend up to 6 months a year in India. And we've been trying to do that. We have a little home in our ashram in Gurgaon, a little flat. And so we live in India. At this point, it's about 4 or 5 months of the year. And a lot of traveling and teaching. And we arrived yesterday in Pune. And we'll have this weekend here. Then there's a big public talk Sunday morning at the Yashoda Center. And then we'll be back here for next weekend. And we've been very fortunate to have been had the teachings and training of this great saint, Swami Kriyananda. And we were quite young when we came, 22 years old, in different times. But Swami was, as we said, a direct disciple of Paramahansa Yogananda. And he was a wonderful trainer of people because he made, and this is what we'll talk about during the weekend, he didn't create a division between spiritual life and daily life. He made it all seem like a flow, like God was everywhere. He was in your family. He was in your business. He was in your devotion. He was wherever you looked for him, he could be found. So this really is so much of what Ananda Sanya shares, which is how to bring spirituality, how to bring devotion into your everyday life. And the talk that we'll give on Sunday morning is, the title is Paramahansa Yogananda Avatar for this Age. And part of, we will give away our talk then tonight, but really the more I understand really what Master's mission was, is the more I see how what he brought exactly helps modern people today. Because there's one line in Autobiography of a Yogi, it's chapter Babaji's Interest in the West, in which Master writes, "Babaji foresaw the complexities and materialistic influence of Western society and the influence it would have on India. And that's why he sent, Babaji sent Master to the West to help introduce, to balance, bring spirituality to the West so that the world would not be so out of balance with materialism versus spirituality, but to show how they both could be balanced together. So I'll be sharing these ideas over the weekend.
To a certain extent, you might think of Master being sent to the West by Babaji as an inoculation for a disease of imbalance that was needed. One of Master's primary missions was to bring about a balance between the East and West, because he said the West had developed very well in material efficiency, and that is part of life. You need that. But if you have that as your God, you get very, very out of balance. And so he said that many Indian souls were being born in America, especially because that's where his mission was. Many Indian souls were being born in America, so that when he planted the seeds of meditation and seeking God that we now see has been developing and developing until almost, I doubt there's anyone in America who doesn't know the term yoga, who doesn't understand that meditation is good for someone. They may not understand why or even what it is, but they know that it's something that's helpful, just as good health, good eating is helpful. So all of that didn't exist until the beginning of the inoculation against the spiritual disease of materialism. On the other hand, he said many Western souls are being born in India because India needs to develop in terms of material efficiency. And so, you know, many of the developments, I mean, probably most of you have a smartphone in your pocket, and all of that technology is allowing things that wouldn't be able, you know, industry, economics, communication, the ability to move around easily, many, many good influences, and also some negative influences. But that balance is taking place, and we're trying in the little microcosm of the world of Ananda to produce the ideal balance, so that we have the primary focus being on spirituality, on one's relationship with God, and along with that, not rejecting modern technology, but not making it our God. So Master used the phrase simple living and high thinking to capture that. So material efficiency, but simple living, not seeking more and more happiness outside of yourself. And so this balance, we're trying to produce a model society. And we know that Master said that during this age, these, he called the world brotherhood colonies, would spread like wildfire. Well, the wildfire right now is only a few sparks around the globe. But those sparks are very important, because people have a model where they can come and see. Some of you, maybe many of you, have seen the movie Finding Happiness. And if not, it would be very good to see that. I don't know if we're showing it on the weekend. But on Sunday, sit down on a big screen. So if you haven't seen that, you can see the blending of these two that Master. Anyway, we don't want to do a lecture tonight. Tonight is for questions and answers. So if you have any questions, David will answer them.
There was a mother who went to wake up her son to go to school. And he said, I don't want to go to school today, and pulled the covers over his head. And she said, you have to get up and go to school. And he said, I don't want to go, and I have two reasons. All the teachers hate me, and all the children hate me. And the mother shook him and said, you still have to go to school. And there are two reasons. You're 51
absolutely near the principal.
That made her smile.
Okay, I'll tell you.
This is about a little dog, a little beagle dog. And some just little dog got loose from the home, and he was wandering out, and he was wandering in the jungle. And he was in a clearing, and all of a sudden, he saw a tiger coming out of the woods and beginning to come toward him. He was very smart. He knew he couldn't run away fast enough. But there was a big pile of bones in the middle of this clearing. And so he went, and he turned his back toward the tiger. And as the tiger slowly approached, he began chewing on a bone. And when the tiger got quite close, he said, "I think this is the best tiger I've eaten lately." And so the tiger got frightened and then ran off into the jungle. But there was a monkey in a tree, and the monkey was watching, and he saw what was going on. And so the monkey ran after the tiger because he thought, "I'll tell him, and then I'll get in his good graces, and he'll protect me." So that about an hour later, the tiger and the monkey came back. And now the tiger was not only hungry, but angry. And so the beagle saw the two of them together and knew immediately what must have happened. So once again, he ran to the pile of bones and turned his back toward the tiger and was chewing on the bone. And when the tiger got close enough, he said, "I don't know what could have happened. It must be at least an hour since I sent that monkey off to bring me another tiger."
We're running out of jokes. But I would like to tell you, this isn't a joke, but it was a very good comment that someone said to me recently. We were visiting an old temple in India recently, and the guide was kind of rough, broken steps, and the guide was helping me in. Let me take a step by myself. And finally, I was thinking, I really can't walk, you know. And so I said, "Thank you, but, you know, I'm not that old." And he said, "No, ma'am, you are young, but these steps are very old." So I thought, well, that was a very diplomatic answer. And some of them are funny, some of them are very moving, some of them are joyful, some of them are dramatic. It's hard to put them in a category, but let's see. This is more of a life story, just to show just an approach to life without attachment. And we have, at Ananda Village in California, we have a very lovely little place similar to this called a meditation retreat. It's in the woods and very simple little cabins and not electricity and, you know, very, very simple. And then one, I think it was the second year or so after its operation, after it began working, someone had been meditating in the temple, which was made of wood, one evening, and they left a candle burning, and somehow it caught the altar cloth, and no one was around, and the temple burned down. And when Swami was told this, withdrew a little bit and meditated. And then he came out and he was happy and he was centered in himself. And we went to a local nearby little shop and he walked in and he was kind of singing to himself. And the owner knew that our temple had burned down and she said, "My gosh, you're singing. When my praying for 6 months. And Swamiji said, we lost the temple. I didn't lose my voice. I can still sing. And it was just so much of life is learning how to deal with change and loss and not lose your joy. Because that's all life really is change. You lose some things, you gain some things. But there's, you know, one of the profound teachings of the Dhamma is that this world isn't real. And it's just a dream. And so things may seem to go, and things may seem to come, but what is eternal is that the nature of God, as it's described, Satchitananda, ever-existing, ever-conscious, ever-new joy. And that's what Swami was demonstrating in that story.
Talking about the favorite story is probably impossible. It would change from day to day, but just looking over, I see a picture of Nanda Moima. So this is a story that happened in 1974. Swamiji and two or three others from Ananda came, including myself, came to India, and among other things, we went to the Kumbh Mela in Hardwar. And Ananda Moima had an ashram there, and she was staying there because of the Kumbha. And so we spent 3 days interacting with Ma. It was very wonderful and very blissful. But on the final day, we had a little satsang. There weren't too many people at the ashram, maybe a group about the size of this, a dozen, 15 people. And she was up on a little dais, and people were seated on the pavement. And she was, at this time, her mood changed each time we saw her. But this time she was just very joyful and very childlike, and she was kind of laughing and happy. And someone came up and gave her a garland of flowers, and she had it on for maybe a minute, and then she took it off. And Swami was sitting in the first row, about as far away as those seats. She took it off and she went like that, and it went right around Swami's neck. And she clapped her hands and loved that. And then she had little yellow handkerchiefs with rock candy and as prasad. And she had one brought out and she threw it to each one of us. And as we caught it, at this time, she was just almost like a teenager, just happy and laughing and giggling. Just 2 days before, she had been absolutely as if not even there, just maybe off in the astral plane. She barely was recognizing people. So her kind of divine mood, kakea, would change from time to time. Pardon? Kayla. And so this was after the incident with the little group satsang, because we were leaving and we were catching a train back to Delhi where we had been staying. And so the party left, but Swamiji wanted to stay. There was a very, very close relationship with Ma, and very, very loving both directions. And he had spent a lot of time with Ma in 1958 through 62, and there was a very, very dear relationship. So he wanted to stay and just privately be able to give her his love and say goodbye. And so we went and packed up all of our things and went, and we were at the train station. And in fact, we had gotten on the train because it was time for the train to depart. And still Swami wasn't there. And he wasn't there. And it was actually after the time the train was supposed to leave. And then we saw him kind of running down the platform. And he just got there, just got on the train, and then it started up and left. told us that he had been in a small, just three or four people with Juan, and he said he could not physically leave her presence. The love and magnetism was so strong. And she must have read his mind because she finally got up and went in a little apartment she had there and closed the door. But when that happened, then the magnetism broke and he could leave. And then he ran and caught the train. And in fact, I think she probably held the train long enough for him to be able to get there and get on. But this beautiful divine play, really all it is it's a play of love with the divine. And we might think of God as a tyrant or God as uncaring, but all it is a play of love. That's a very good question. There are several things that, one, if you could stand back and not look at just the details of your life, but look from a distance and see what has seemed really important in your life and what are some of the recurring themes that have happened. You know, some people will be rejected by their parents, rejected by, and maybe their life lesson is learning how to deal with them. Others will have a great desire for a spiritual life, but have to face obstacles in order to fulfill it. So if you can pull back and look at the thrust of almost like the long-term thrust. And just in meditation, if you can, ask deeply, what was I born in order to learn? Because it won't be the things that happened to you. That's not all that important. It will be what you have learned through the things that happened to you. And so it's almost like pull back and say, what am I meant to learn in this life? Is it inner strength? Is it devotion? Is it material efficiency, the ability to function in the world? Well, but for each of us, there will be a kind of a dominant theme. And sometimes you can find it out best by your own intuition and by God's guidance. Sometimes people who are close to you might, if they're wise, might be able to help you see that. But it will always be something for your learning and maturing and expanding your consciousness. And there will be some quality that you've come into this lifetime in order to develop further. It doesn't mean that you didn't have it. Maybe it's a further development. And so I think primarily that.
Yes, that was a good answer. I don't have much to add, but just a little experience that I had had. Once we were leading a group of people on a retreat, and that was one of the themes. I would tune into your own life's lesson. And we did an exercise together. We all had a little notebook, and we wrote down, think about your life and think about the major challenges you have faced in your life. And then look at those and try to see the underlying unifying thread that was present in all of those circumstances. Maybe you lost a little pet when you were a little one, your friends, and that was very hard. So, and then you look and say, well, I guess the underlying theme in all of my tests was being attached to things, and that's what I need to learn to overcome. So it's helpful if you take the time to reflect. You can usually see a similar pattern in all the challenges that you faced, and then try to crystallize that in your mind. And then, you know, one of the real gifts of a spiritual life is the ability to change patterns, habitual patterns of thinking and reacting, both through meditation, through practicing techniques that release karma, and also through the Guru's grace. And it's really, you know, I've known many, many spiritual seekers in my life, and it's such a beautiful thing when, particularly because we came when we were young and we had a whole peer group, and you see people who come and you see, oh, that person tends to get angry easily, or whatever the quality may be that they need to overcome. And then you see over the years how people really work on themselves. Maybe they don't talk about it, but you can see they're trying to control their anger or restlessness or whatever it might be, the quality. And then you see, you know, that person's really a different person now. So we can change the tests and limitations of our consciousness. These are, if we ask God to help us to transform our consciousness, it really is possible. And there's a beautiful chant that one of Master's disciples wrote, and the words are, before my eyes, my dead self lies, or bliss beyond compare. And so, meaning you look at the ego and the egoic qualities that through God's grace and our own sincere desire to change, they can just fall away. And then you look at your old self and you just feel so much joy because you realize you're not limited by those things anymore. It's a great victory. Our true nature is the bliss of God. Everything else is just a reflection of the ego. Swamiji called the ego a bundle of self-definitions. And you untie the knot of ego and all those sticks of self-definitions just fall away. So we're not our personality. We're not our mind. There was a very advanced direct disciple of Guruji who spent many years with him, a master's direct disciple, and in her old age she became very senile and she didn't have anyone to care for her, so we took her into the Ananda ashram in California and cared for her. And but she didn't know anything. She, you know, didn't remember from one day to the next. And someone said to Swami Kriyananda, oh, what a shame that, you know, this great disciple is just now senile. And Swami said, oh, it's just the mind. Her soul is still in bliss. It's not important. So all of the things that we think are ourselves, try to just see them as a new one, an observer. Just observe, oh, I have the tendency to be impatient, or I have the tendency to, try to think of myself before others, whatever it might be. And say, but that's not me. That's a part of the way that I'm expressing myself. But the true self, the soul, the Atman, is just the bliss of God. And everything else is a false identity.
is really defining us. We're beyond and free from all of those, even though those patterns might be quite fixed in one lifetime. But going back to your first question, one of the reasons for each life is to help us work and release the hold that some pattern or many patterns have on us. And the best way to do that is not to fight against this or fight against that and try to overcome this, but rather to dive deep in devotion or deep in a relationship with God or deep in meditation, because I don't know an illustration, but there may be many, many qualities that we have that we would like to overcome, almost like all these ropes that are holding us down. But once you cut the primary rope, the balloon of our consciousness rises up and all those things fall off. One time, Swami had a very refined palate and he liked good food. And he thought of it as a difficulty. And one time he said to Master, you know, I have to try to overcome this desire, this liking of good food. And Master said, it's not important. Once God comes, all these little things go. And so the real effort should be to get closer to God and deeper in meditation. And there may be some patterns that we have to fight against. You know, some things like, I don't know, laziness or drug use or many things like that that we have to overcome because they don't allow us to make a better effort. But generally speaking, let go of the little things. Don't try to negate things, but try to affirm your oneness with God, and those things begin to fall away.
We're talking with someone that had acted in a way that caused them and others some suffering, and they were saying that they felt so guilty. And they were saying, you know, guilt is not a very useful emotion. All it does is make you more self-focused, but better to say, I will try to improve that now at this point in my life. We had Swami had a cook and a housekeeper who was a dear friend of ours, and her husband, he was an athlete and he went out for a run. And he died, he had a heart attack and died very unexpectedly. It was a great shock to her. This was Lita's husband. And she, unfortunately, the day that he had gone out for the run, just as he was going out the door, they had a little disagreement. And that was the last time that she saw her. He had a heart attack. And so she came to Swami and she said, oh, I feel so badly. You know, we ended with some disharmonious words, and I don't have a chance to make it right. And Swami said, don't live in regret. It doesn't help. You live in gratitude for all the positive and happy years that you had together. And so it is with our life in general. Of course, if we've made a mistake, we have to try to do better. But to dwell on, oh, I'm a bad person, I did this bad thing and all that, it just focuses on the negative side of ourselves. It's better just to say, as a master sometimes would look at all of his disciples gathered, and he would say, I see you all as beings of light. If you only knew how beautiful you were. And that's how God sees us. He doesn't see our flaws. He sees our soul nature. And it helps us. You know, you can't, we often say, if you plant a flower, I'm such a slow growing plant, and why can't they do better, and why can't you make a bigger flower? But if you just nurture it with water and good light and nutrients from the soil, then the flower grows. And it's the same with ourselves. If we're very self-critical, then it just, our energy shuts down. If we say, I am going to try to do the best I can in this life. Yes, I made a mistake here and there, but I'm not letting that define me. And just to almost be like your own best friend and just say, you can do a good job, you can do better. And just keep moving that way. Now, any last question, because it's getting difficult.
The most important thing is to change yourself. So we can't always change the environment, but we can change the, usually we can change the environment that is close around. So start by changing your own reactions. Secondly, that will affect those who are very close, like your family, so that it'll become more harmonious. But the attempt to change society is a very long-range pattern. Again, thinking of Ananda Moyma, one time at the split of India, partition of India and Pakistan, someone came to her and begged her to intercede and use her spiritual power to change the president of Pakistan at the time. And she was just quiet for quite a long time, about an hour. And then she said, don't you think he who made this world knows how to run it? And that was her answer. And so there are certain long-range things that are just there as mass karma, and we can't do much about that. But we can change a little area that most affects us. The most affecting is our own consciousness, that of those right around us. If we can affect our work environment a little bit to make that nourishing, to affect that and uplift it, then we can change that. But none of us are going to change the traffic patterns in India at this point. And if we allow that to get us all riled up, or all the criticism and negativity, then we lose our own peace. And so work on that which you can effectively change, which is yourself and a few others, and perhaps joining together in a group like this with satsang, with other spiritual seekers, you can help create a mini environment, like an Ananda environment, where most of those problems don't exist. And little examples of that will help provide the gradual change to society. But if you focus, so many people focus on things that they can't really do anything about. I'll give just one story. I have two very good friends that I grew up with and went to college with, and they're very fine people. But we were visiting them one time, and they're quite politically active. And so it was at the time that America was invading Iraq, and there were many people who felt that was wrong. And so this was in Minneapolis, Minnesota, in America. And so there was a big protest march where people were marching and they were banging cymbals and shouting and had slogans and signs protesting against the war. And they wanted us to come and join in the protest march. And Davey and I said, well, we'll protest in our own way. We don't think that peace will come by being angry. Peace will come by sending out loving thoughts. So instead of marching and protesting, we meditated and sent out prayers for peace and for the proper vibrations. So the point being is that you have to start with yourself and your own consciousness, and you be the change that you want to see in the world. And if you're the change, then something at least in the world will change. Whereas if you're just angry and negative, it actually locks things more into place. But many changes are needed.
Just add briefly that, you know, we meet many people in India, and I think the question you just asked is the question that we hear asked most frequently. And it's a time of moral transition, not only in India, but in the whole world. And it's like we're swimming in polluted water. It's all around us. But I think it's very important for people of integrity to draw a line and say, I'll try to work without disharmony, but there's a point where I compromise my own integrity and I won't step over that line. And if enough people can begin doing that, then the consciousness begins to shift and the moral and ethical pollution that we see all around us will begin to lose its grip on people's minds. We have a friend who was convicted. He's in prison. He was convicted of a murder unjustly. The judge was bribed, the lawyers were bribed. And he's been in prison for 20 years. He's a great man. He's a disciple of our path. He's a very fine man. We've visited him in prison a number of times. And when he went in, when he was convicted, he was in his mid-20s. Now he's in his mid-40s. But he was telling us when we visited him recently that in the prison environment, there's gangs. And if you don't get under the protection of a gang, you can be beaten. You can be, you know, it's very hard. And so he was transferred to a new prison. And these gangs were saying, okay, you have to do what we tell you or we're going to kill you. So you have to go and beat up those other people. And he just looked at them, the head of the gang, and he said, I have seen so much suffering in the years I've been in prison. I refuse to inflict suffering on another human being. If you want to kill me, you kill me. But I'm not going to hurt anybody else. And they just walked away. And they never bothered him anymore. And, you know, that took great moral courage to do that. But I think that's what the times we live in demand, that we just say, you know, I'm not going to point out somebody else as a criminal, but I'm not going to be a criminal myself. So I think we've